So I've put out quite a few videos about my battery and solar installation over the last couple of years, and I get regular comments, apart from the ones that are telling me it's a waste of money and doesn't work, even though it does work and it's saving me a fortune. But I've had a lot of comments asking me how various components are wired up, and because I've got a GivEnergy gateway that lets me run my whole home off-grid if I wanted to, that obviously requires some special consideration. So let's get started. So this video is aimed at those people who are considering getting a GivEnergy battery and maybe want to learn more about how all of the various components connect together. Or maybe you're just here because you want to have a nose around at how my system is wired up, because there are a couple of unusual things about it which I will show you later, I promise. Or maybe you're an installer who wants to see how one's been put in real life. If you are an installer, you should really go and do the proper GivEnergy training though. So let's start with a quick recap of what I've got. There's a GivEnergy All-in-One which has 13.5 kilowatt hours of storage and can provide 6 kilowatts of sustained power. You'll also notice a GivEnergy AC coupled inverter there too, and an 8.2 kilowatt hour battery underneath that. Up on my roof there are 10 390 watt panels, and they are all connected to a SolarEdge string inverter. I do also have a Daikin heat pump for my central heating, which of course requires power, and a GivEnergy EV charger at the front of my house. So it's quite a complicated setup really, and the best way to explain how it all fits together is with a diagram. If you like diagrams, then you're in for a treat with this video. It all starts outside with my really filthy meter box. Inside the meter box is my smart meter. I have a single phase grid feed with an 80 amp fuse, so that limits my import to about 17 kilowatts-ish, realistically. The tails from my smart meter run into my garage and straight into the GivEnergy gateway. So this is the GivEnergy gateway, and inside you'll see lots of RCDs and MCBs for various circuits, and also a couple of energy monitors up here for monitoring your solar generation and your grid. Those tails from the smart meter are connected to the grid MCB. There is a bypass switch next to it with a protective cover on, and if you ever had a fault with the gateway that for some reason was causing your home to lose power, you can flip that switch and it physically connects your home straight to the grid. But it's very important that it's not left on under normal conditions. Inside my house, I have a bog standard consumer unit, and inside there you'll find switches for all of my various in-home power circuits. On the left, I have RCD protection for my downstairs and upstairs lights. Then in the middle, I've got another RCD protecting the oven circuit, plus the smoke and burglar alarms and a socket in my garage. Now on the right, you can see two RCBOs, one for each of my socket circuits. Now this is quite critical because a lot of houses actually have all of their circuits on just one RCD, or maybe split across two RCDs. The problem is people have loads of gadgets plugged in these days, and every gadget leaks a bit to your earth. As you plug more gadgets in, that total earth leakage starts to add up. RCDs are designed to trip when they detect a particular threshold of earth leakage, which can protect you from getting a nasty electric shock. But if the GivEnergy gateway takes you off grid during a power cut, when the power returns, there can be, for just a fraction of a second, a slight increase in earth leakage as it cuts back over. That can be enough to trip your RCDs that are already close to the limit. So what's the solution then? Well, I had the problem fixed by putting each of my socket circuits on their own RCBOs. That way the total earth leakage is actually split between the RCD for my lights, the RCD for my oven and garage, and an RCBO for the downstairs socket and an RCBO for the upstairs sockets. It's the same amount of earth leakage, but because it's more evenly distributed, each breaker has more headroom. So if you get tripping when testing grid failures, then go for RCBOs for your circuits. The consumer unit is directly connected to the gateway on the MCB labelled load, which means that it will be protected by the battery in the event of a power cut, and is monitored by the gateway as load. The all-in-one itself connects to the gateway's all-in-one switch. It's AC coupled, so there's a live and a neutral wire, plus a data cable which is Cat5 or Cat6 RJ45 terminated. Then we come to the EV charger. I have a GivEnergy EV charger, but any brand of EV charger will work with the gateway. The gateway doesn't come with an RCD or MCB for an EV charger, so you have to fit your own. You can wire it either on the load side or the grid side of the gateway, depending on whether you want it to be seen by the gateway or not. I have mine wired on the grid side, so as it is not backed up by the battery, but it's wired after the gateway CT clamp so as the gateway can see the power that it's pulling. And talking of CT clamps, your EV charger should have a CT clamp so as it can monitor the grid. Now, a lot of chargers like PodPoint or Zappy can have a CT clamp directly wired into them, and that can be clipped over the live grid tail from your smart meter. The GivEnergy EV charger actually uses a separate energy monitor like an EM115, and you can see that little green display that's sitting in the gateway next to the RCD for the EV charger. And of course we need to think about solar panels. Now GivEnergy have recently announced a new hybrid all-in-one, so you'd be able to wire your solar panels straight into it with no other boxes needed. But for the normal all-in-one, you'll need a separate inverter. That could be micro inverters or a string inverter, but the end result should be an AC feed. In my case, I have a SolarEdge SE3680H string inverter connected to a single string of solar panels on my roof. The inverter connects straight to the 32 amp PV switch inside the gateway. Now, earlier on, I did say that there was something unusual about my setup, so as promised, here goes. I have an older AC coupled GivEnergy inverter and 8.2 kilowatt hour battery, and it's really not designed to work alongside the all-in-one. If you are watching this and work for GivEnergy, then please look away now. Go on, you don't want to watch this next bit. The AC3 inverter is connected to my main consumer unit, so it's effectively seen by the all-in-one as a load. I've then got an EM115 energy meter with a CT clamp monitoring the live grid feed going into the gateway. The big problem with running these two inverters together is cross-charging. You get a runaway condition with a second inverter thinking that the output from the first is actually excess power it can charge from. So the first inverter increases its power output, which the second inverter starts charging from, and it just keeps increasing. When I first set this up, I used Home Assistant to manage this cross-charging issue by pausing one of the batteries when it was detected, or pausing a battery if one was being used more than the other. I actually made a whole video about that, which you can check out if you're interested in, but I don't actually do that anymore. What I actually do is leave my all-in-one in eco mode all the time, apart from the timed charge off-peak. And the AC3 also does a timed charge, but then for the rest of the day, I have a timed export, but limited to about 330 watts, which roughly matches my base load. There's an automation in Home Assistant too, which prevents the AC3 from exporting too much when there's a lot of solar. I'm on the Octopus Go tariff, which gives me 5 hours of off-peak energy every night to charge the car and the batteries with. It's a simple tariff to work with. If you are considering switching to Octopus Energy, then please use my referral code that's on the screen right now. We'll both get £50 of credit when your switch is completed, and it really helps to support this channel. Back to the balancing automation though. I'm not going to go into the exact details of why I changed my approach on balancing the batteries, because I have a whole future video planned to go over that, but I'm mentioning it here just so as you have the full picture. Anyway, let's finish up by talking about the heat pump. So let's clear a bit of space on the diagram because it's got a bit busy. I've got a 6 kilowatt Daikin heat pump. Now that doesn't mean it uses 6 kilowatts, that's its heat output rating. It actually only uses maybe 2 kilowatts maximum. There is also a booster heater in the hot water tank too, so the whole circuit could pull 6 kilowatts in the worst case. Octopus Energy installed the heat pump for me, and they tapped into the load side of the gateway, putting in a dedicated consumer unit for the heat pump. This means that in the event of a power cut, my heating will still work. I think this is the best way to wire it up personally, although the installation team were up to discuss options. Anyway, I hope you found this useful. If you did, then please give this video a like. A massive thank you to these guys here who are my channel members for supporting my channel. If you'd like to get early access to my videos and exclusive members only content, then check out the link in the description for more information on joining. Don't forget to make sure you are subscribed to my channel too for free to see more from me. Thank you for watching. Goodbye.